Stuck in Nostalgia. That is a good song. It's actually on the wall up there. Are tubes just nostalgic nonsense that need no longer exist? Outdated rubbish? Or is there something genuinely magical about them, which is why so many people love them? This is the Woo WA22. It is a fully balanced transformer-coupled tube headphone amp with up to 2 watts of power, and I really, really like this amp. Now, this video is going to be both a review of the WA22 itself, obviously, but it's also going to be talking a little bit about tubes versus solid state. There are some people who think that solid state absolutely performs better, it's objectively better, and therefore there's no reason whatsoever to ever get a tube amp. There are some people who think that tubes are the best thing since sliced bread, and that solid state will never ever come close to sounding as natural as a tube amp will. Personally, I sit kind of in the middle. I really like tube amps, and I really like solid state, but I consider them as entirely different categories. If you asked me, is this better than a Hollow Serene? Is that better than an AHP2? They're just different. I wouldn't compare them against each other. It's not something where I'd go, I'm not sure if I want an AHP2 or a WA22. I'd want both, because they're doing different things. They're not competing with each other. They sound and behave so different. Now, when it comes to tube amps, there are a lot of different designs, and typically you'll see tube amps as single-ended. It's a lot rarer to see a balanced tube amp than it is to see a single-ended one. This is a fully balanced one. It does have a single-ended out, but it is intended to be fed and outputting balanced. There are lots of different designs when it comes to tube amps. There are hybrid amps. This is a Shit Valley 2, for example, and a hybrid means it has a tube pre-stage and then a solid state output stage. There are output transformerless or OTL amps like the Dark Voice, for example. Those are preferred by some, but they limit you mostly to using dynamic drivers, and that's because they have extremely high output impedance. And so if you try and use a planar, the damping factor is going to be almost non-existent. So that can create some problems. This, however, is a transformer-coupled amp, and that means that actually, as well as just having a low output impedance, you've actually got a selection of 2 different output impedances that you'd like, high and low. You can use any of them on any headphone, and I'll talk a little bit about how those 2 sound. And it also means that on the second generation WA22, you can use it as a preamp. That feature is an absolute godsend for me, and it's going to make this a really appealing choice for a lot of people. Why? Well, because this sounds fantastic on its own, and it's pretty powerful. It gets up to 2 watts of power, which means you're not going to have any trouble driving just about any headphone. But some headphones you might not quite have enough, like the Susvara, for example. The Hi-Fi Man Susvara is my main headphone. That's my reference point. But it's really hard to drive. And if you've ever listened to a Susvara and or an HE6 on a speaker amp, you know how much of an improvement that is when you give it more power. So these sound good on the WA22. They really, really do. But they scale a lot with power. And so I can use this as a preamp to feed my AHP2 and then use that to feed the Susvara. So that means that I've got that tube sound injected into my chain whilst getting all the power to drive these headphones properly. So that's fantastic. You can also go the other way. Let's say you've got some really sensitive IEMs. Instead of just plugging them directly into this and getting hum or something, you can use this as a preamp to feed a much lower noise solid-state IEM amp, like a Topping L30 or something. This, having a preamp, gives it a huge amount of flexibility so that you don't just have to run stuff directly off it. You can use this for a stereo setup, you can use this for other headphone amps, you can use this in any kind of way to give your chain that tube flavor, even if running headphones directly off it might not be the best plan. But with most headphones, just run them straight off because it sounds absolutely fantastic. I am using the Focal Alex at the moment, but I've also been trying a various selection of headphones. The Arias sound amazing off this. The HD800, which has a reputation, well-deserved, for tubing well, sounds amazing on this. At the moment for this review, though, I'm using the Focal Alex. So let's talk about the build then. The build is really, really sturdy. This is what some might refer to as an absolute unit. It is an 11 kilogram massive block of metal. It's heavy, it's big, and it's not going to fit on a lot of people's desks. Some people hate that. Some people just want something tiny and compact that will fit on their desk in any nook and cranny, and that's totally fine. For me, I'm one of those weird people that really likes big pieces of gear. I really like it when there is something fat and substantial. I mean, I've got, you know, the May and a speaker amp on the desk and everything. I like big, heavy pieces of gear. This does dissipate quite a lot of heat as well. This pulls about 50 watts from the wall, if I remember correctly, and it dissipates heat very evenly. There's no real hot spots or anything other than, of course, the tubes themselves, but the whole chassis does get pretty toasty. So just Plan accordingly if you are wanting to use this in a desk setup. It's big, it's heavy, and it does dissipate a lot of heat. The actual quality of the build is really, really nice though. Everything from just the engraving is really, really sharp, both the Woo Audio logo and also the labels for the tubes here, which these are not the stock tubes, by the way. I wasn't super keen on the stock tubes. I thought that these ones were a lot better. These are Thompson CSF 6080 WAs and Tung Sol 6SN7 tubes, but I've left the rectifier stock. These cost me less than 100 quid in total, so it's not exactly an expensive swap, and obviously tubes are kind of a personal preference thing. Tubes will change the sound of your amp, so try different tubes. That's part of the fun of having a tube amp, is rolling and finding what works best for you. So those are the tubes that I'm using and that I have been using for evaluating this amp, because to me they sounded a lot better than the stock ones. On the front, we have the volume knob itself, which not even the slightest hint of misalignment, and a proper spoon in honey kind of feel. No scratchiness, no stiffness, not too light, absolutely perfect. And also, what I really like is that there's no channel imbalance, like, at all. For the maybe the, you know, first degree or so, you get channel imbalance, and then that's it. Whereas a lot of lower cost pots will have channel imbalance, sometimes for the first hour or two on the clock. So the pot here is really, really nice. You have left and right 3-pin XLR connectors, and that's so that you can have one cable going straight from the left output to your left cup and one from your right cup to the right output. I am just using this, which is the standard 4-pin XLR connector, as will most people. There is a 6.35mm jack as well if you want to use single-ended. And here is the off-on switch, which also doubles as a selector for high and low output impedance and switching it to preamp mode. Let's have a look at the back. On the back, we have the IEC power inlet, details about the fuse if you need to replace that, so that's handy. Voltage switch, 110 to 230 volts, so that whatever region you're in, you should be able to use it just with a flick of that switch. Balanced XLR preamp outputs. And for the inputs, we have a set of balanced XLR ins and single-ended RCA ins. There is also a switch, which you need to toggle depending on if you are on balanced or single-ended. And if you are using balanced, you also need to put these on. These are plugs that go over the RCA connectors. Woo made quite clear you need to put those on if you are using balanced. So this is built substantially, really nicely. Why would you buy tubes if solid state almost always performs better? And the simple answer is they sound different. You can't replicate the sound of a tube amp on a solid state amp, and you can't replicate the sound of a solid state amp on a tube amp. They just sound different. They behave different from an objective standpoint. And this is one of those situations where you really do just have to put the surface level measurements aside. I'm a fan of objective performance. My main chain is the highest objectively performing R2R DAC, the highest objectively performing non-Class D speaker amp, and the highest objectively performing active preamp. And I've got an audio precision analyzer over there. But I like this a lot. It sounds fantastic. So why? Well, it's because they are just different. Tubes and transistors sound different and behave different. Solid state amps are very reliant on something called global feedback. And in modern designs, we're also seeing a lot of feed forward error correction. Tubes are more linear than transistors without the use of global feedback. Does that make a difference? A lot of people will say, well, if you just use global feedback, then you get more performance, so it doesn't matter. But if you've ever tried something like a GSX Mini, a Holo Serene, a Sync RSA-1, or high-performing amps, sort of discrete, compare it to, say, a THX-789, which is an extremely error-correction-reliant amp. Performs objectively really well, sounds completely different. And that's a similar situation here. It's not about the surface level measurements, it's about the fact that these are built from the ground up completely differently and behave completely differently. So yeah, if you want the highest objective performance, then go buy a solid state amp. But tube amps just sound different. Go try one, go see what you think of it, and the people who say tube amps are different or suit their preferences more and you can't replicate it on a solid state amp, they're right, because it's just so different. So one of the stereotypes as such of tube amps is that they have a holographic soundstage. Now, to me, holographic doesn't just mean a big soundstage. It's a good quality of stage. It means that things are positioned within it, all the vocalists and different elements have their own space, everything's layered. It's about size and quality, not just one or the other. So let's demonstrate size first, because this does stage very well. This is Inner Light by Bob Moses, and on a big sounding setup, this can be huge. Everything Everything's massive. Everything's super duper far away, and it's doing an absolutely fantastic job there. But it's not just about sounding big. It's about things within that stage being properly positioned. And so if we do something like Tash Sultana's Blackbird. The guitar is clearly positioned. It's clearly present. It's not just about being far away or in a particular direction. It's there. And you can hear all the micro detail and all the little low-level stuff exceptionally clearly. So the holographic soundstage thing definitely applies. This is a fantastic amp for soundstage, both in terms of size and in quality. One of the other misconceptions about a tube amp is that it's just warm and mushy, and that's absolutely not the case. Let's talk about the mushy part first. The primary reason why you might get a somewhat mushy sound is output impedance. So this might be an issue on OTL amps, particularly if you're trying to run planars. But this is a transformer coupled amp. And as well as that, I can actually lower the output impedance by just turning that knob like that. And now, if I continue this track, those transients, the plucks on the strings, are incredibly crisp and clear. One track to demonstrate this really well is the Disarm You Grey remix, originally by Cascade. This has got a lot of really transient heavy stuff, and it demonstrates when something can be sounding a bit slow very easily. Wait on your soul. The kick drum synth is really, really thumpy and fast. The, again, strumming of those strings are fantastically crisp and clear without at all being sibilant or harsh. And the vocals are completely separate at the same time. It's not encroaching on anything else's space. It's doing a, from a technical standpoint, really, really nice job. Warmth, then. A lot of people will say that tube amps are warmer than solid state, and I don't think that's the case, because, well, firstly, warmth to me is a frequency response difference, and this has a flat frequency response, as do many other tube amps. Unless the tubes that you put in are screwed or something, that's not what's going on. What's going on is that this has more second-order harmonics than most solid-state amps will, and that makes things sound more tonally dense, which is something that a lot of people, including myself, like a lot from time to time. These tubes actually are a little bit more of that than the stock tubes, but I've done that quite deliberately because that's what I want when I listen to a tube amp, so I've put those in. And this track, which is Unjaded by Deadmau5, describes this difference quite well, because if you put this on something like an A90, it sounds too thin. It sounds too thin and lightweight, detailed and impressive, but not real. If you listen to it on a GSX Mini or a Holoserene, for example, it's absolutely spot on. And then when I want a little bit of extra vividness and life and more texture than is really there, but in a really enjoyable way, that's where I go for this. And it shows this difference really, really well. Something Deadmau5 doesn't make real music. That's a fantastic. In fact, that whole album's really, really good. Links to all the music in the description, by the way. So this has a greater tonal density than a lot of solid state amps, and that's something which some people might dislike. I personally really, really like it. I wouldn't necessarily want it all the time, but I really, really want it at least as an option, which is kind of why I wish I could keep this. So this is a wonderfully resolving amp. It stages beautifully, both in terms of size and actual holographic positioning and space within it. The layering is perfect. That tonal density and timbre is slightly larger than life, which is exactly what I want if I'm going for a tube amp. If I'm going solid state, I want something more neutral, sometimes even maybe more clinical, like an A90 or something. But if I'm going for tubes, that's exactly what I want, and that's exactly what this is giving me. Some people might be worried that with a tube amp such as this, they're not going to get that dynamic impact for EDM or electronic type music, and that's not a problem. This is False Work by Adam Tell. All the synths, all the drums, everything are punchy and fast and absolutely wonderful. There's no issues here with electronic music. I would probably still get a solid state amp if you only listen to that kind of stuff, but this absolutely handles that no problem whatsoever. You're not going to get anything missing. So as you can probably tell, I like this amp a lot. Is there anything bad about it? The only thing that I can really think of is the stock tubes. I didn't like the stock tubes all that much, but then I just swapped them out for 100 quid, and now it sounds absolutely fantastic. So, no, really. And for the price, you get a lot, because you get a fantastic amp with lots of power, plenty of wonderful qualities, and lots of features, including being able to be used as a preamp, which for me is a godsend. I really like this, and the WA22 has my full recommendation. In terms of alternatives then, the closest relative to this is probably the Cayenne HA6A, which is an amp that I've tried and I liked it a lot. I've not compared the two side by side though, so I'm not going to comment on that. It's more expensive, it's got more power, but you lose the preamp functionality. And for me personally, having heard how good this sounds preamping a speaker amp, I don't think I could give that up. I would really like to get a tube amp to stay here permanently to use in future reviews, but whatever amp that's going to be, it needs to have a preamp. Because that's something which I've enjoyed so much whilst this has been here, preamping my AHB2 with the WA22 and running this as far as off it. It's an absolutely wonderful experience. They sound great off, straight off as well. And for most headphones like the HD800 and stuff like that, obviously just run them straight off. There is no benefit to using a speaker amp there. But for the Svaras, the ability to do that is absolutely wonderful, and I'm really going to miss it. This also has a bigger brother, the WA33, and that's a much more expensive amp. That starts at 7,000 and goes all the way up to 15,000 for the Elite Edition. I am hoping that I might get the opportunity to review that in future. And if I do, I will obviously let you know my thoughts. We'll see what happens there. I hope you enjoyed that video. Join the Discord if you'd like to ask any questions. And a huge thank you to everyone who is supporting me on Patreon. Thank you so much to my Crazy Summit 5 people, Dan Mellinger, Fake Australian Accent, G'day Mate, Ross Kyle, Eskimo Bob, King Jung-un, Dizarasta, and Commodus, my Legend tier subscribers Chris, CK Yozizawazu, Jan R, Jiden the Shiba, and Gravitas, and my Diamond tier subscribers Naivotsu, Adam Cardos, Bean Boawito, Chandler Bassett, Daniel Hibiak, Dwayne Butler, Gizmo1K, Grant Evans, Jeremy Zagorski, Lana Bennett, Luxifer, Nino, Pokey, and Alont. You guys make this happen. Thank you so much.